Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? Well, if so, I'd like to hear about it, and so would everyone else. So go on, send me an email with all the details of your encounter. You can send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Hello there, everyone. I'm glad to see you all tonight because we have a good story coming our way. We just have to get our butts in the saddle and get on down to Sasquatch Valley where all the action is. So, what do you say? Are you ready? Me too. Go grab your snackage and don't forget your drink. And let's get moving out. Dear Nance, I know you start your show off with asking if anyone has been escorted out of the woods by a Sasquatch. Well, it wasn't me, but my dad was. He was attacked by one, and after that, he never went into the woods again, ever. My dad grew up hunting. All of the men in his family hunted, and a lot of the women, too. I even have memories of when I was young of him going out with a bunch of them to go hunting. But all of that stopped before I was old enough to go along with them. We lived in Hendersonville, North Carolina back then. It was a great place if you like to go into the woods. That area is mountainous and covered by thick woods, and national parks and the Great Smoky Mountains are nearby. My dad said that he was out hunting alone one day. Never mind where, because it didn't matter. The location always changed when he told the story. That's the only thing that changed, but you'll find out why later. For years, though, I always suspected there might have been another reason as well as to why he obscured where this happened. I thought it might have been because he was hunting where he shouldn't have been. But he was out hunting in an area that he had hunted successfully, he said, many times before, both when he was alone and when he was with other people. He knew the area, and he felt secure and confident there. He put a tree stand up in a position looking from one incline of land over to another incline that had a stream down on the bottom between them. The land curved so he could see far down the stream, because in that area there was no brush or trees close to the stream itself. He said there were fresh signs all along that area in the morning, and he had located some bedding down areas not far from there the day before. So he settled in to wait in his tree stand to see if the deer came before bedding down for the day, as they usually do. But there was no deer that morning, to his surprise. So he ate a snack bar and settled in back in waiting, hoping they would come for a drink maybe at dusk. He said right as it got a little hazy toward dusk, he was glassing down both areas of the stream that he could see when he was surprised to see another hunter about 100 yards or so away from him. There was an upright person's shape moving behind tall brush. Even with his binoculars, he couldn't see it clearly because of all the brush it was walking in behind. But the movement, it was noticeable through the openings of the brush. He said he didn't realize how tall it was because he didn't know how far down the ground was behind that line of brush. He only figured it out later when he came back to check the area. But that's a later story. Right then, he was pretty upset that some hunter was out there and he had no orange on. I asked my dad why he was so certain it was another hunter, and he looked at me surprised and he said, "Well, Scotty, there wouldn't be anybody else out there like that, would there?" He followed the person with his binoculars as they moved behind the brush. They were making a beeline right to the stream area that he was watching, right where he had seen deer prints and deer scat everywhere. But right before it would have stepped right into the open area at the stream, the person stopped in the brush, and they either sat or squatted down and stayed very still and very low for a long while. This was when my dad said something started bothering him about what he was seeing. He had seen something walking behind the brush, and he was sure it was walking on two legs, so he assumed it had to be another hunter. Now, the little things that he did see between the openings in the thick brush looked like the guy was all bundled up in some big fur coat with a thick hood pulled up tight. And that wasn't unreasonable. It was winter, and the day had peaked out in the 40s, and by midnight it was going to be in the upper teens. But what Dad thought about was he hadn't seen any camo. He hadn't seen any orange notification that he was a hunter. There was no shape of a bow, no arrows. There was nothing equipment related. The light is now getting very low. It's very hazy, and it's getting to be very dark. He said he heard a few snaps of twigs and some leaves shuffle over on the opposite stream side. He looks over, and there's a group of three doe. They're all hanging back, though, at the thick brush line, hesitant to come forward toward the stream. One finally stepped forward, but it was looking directly across the stream, right where the other hunter was concealed. The doe began stomping back and forth with its hooves. Then I heard it snort a few times. Then suddenly all three doe turned and ran back through the brush into the woods, and then they were gone. Dad said he was cursing the other hunter out under his breath, because that hunter had not concealed himself or probably bothered to mask his scent, because the deer obviously knew he was there. He was also cursing because if that other hunter hadn't been out there, he would have had a good, clean shot at any of those doe. But he didn't want to take a chance. He looked back with the binoculars at where the other guy was, and he wasn't doing anything. He hadn't moved an inch. So this guy had messed up Dad's chance with the doe, and he's not moving at all. Great, my dad thought. He's just fuming when he thinks about it. Because strangers hunting the same area, meeting unexpectedly, that's usually not going to go real well. So my dad was mad because he was in a dilemma. Did he leave his tree stand, get down, and leave the area? If he did, he was pretty sure the other guy would then know that he was there. Did he try to wait the other guy out to see if he would move out of the area? Well, that might be all night for all a dad knows, and he wasn't prepared to sit in that tree stand all night. By now, the light is going down fast, so Dad knows if he's going to get down out of that tree, he needs to do it soon, or he's going to be out there stumbling around in the darkness with what he thought was some novice hunter out there who might hear him in the dark and accidentally shoot him. Dad glassed over the area with his binoculars where the guy was, but now it's too dark. So he puts his regular binoculars back in his pocket, and he gets out the small pair of night vision binoculars. He gets them on, adjusted them, and he has the shock of his life. Maybe he made too much noise with his pockets and moving around, he thought. But when he glassed back over to where the other hunter was, well, he wasn't there. He finds him. He's now come out from behind the brush, and he's looking up in the direction that Dad was in. Dad said he doesn't think they made direct visual contact, but it unnerved him seeing that it was not another hunter, and that the animal knew his general direction. At 100 yards, the binoculars gave him a very pristine view. He said it stood every bit of 8 feet tall, and while the fur color wasn't visible with the night vision, he had seen it earlier through the brush, and the color was very dull and dark, but stopped short of calling it pure black. But the thing he saw very well with the night vision was the pattern of the fur as it lay against the body, and he saw that when it moved, the muscles moved, and he could see the fur moving with it. He also saw the face in very good detail, and he noted the eyes reflected and glowed, hollowed in the night vision, as only a set of living eyes could do. So unless someone was on stilts in a gargantuan fur coat costume, those eyes were about 7.5 feet up in the air, and they were very real. He He said there was hair on the face, but it was whisper fine around the eyes and the eyelids, the cheeks, the lips, and the nose. He said the fur pattern was consistent in how it laid, whether it was on the face or anywhere else, which was meaning that the fur worked away from a particular point on the body uniformly, but all the fur didn't go the same way all over. That confused me when he told me, so I asked him to clarify, and he said, "Look at the fur that covers any animal. Take that dog, for example," and he pointed to our beagle. He said, "The fur on her snout usually starts in one area, and it goes all together in one direction, doesn't it? It's kind of split down the face, even on each side, going down the muzzle. But it all starts kind of at one point, which is the middle. But now if you look at her hind end, the same thing is going on. It all goes in different directions, but starts at one point. Even if the fur pattern is subtle, it follows a pattern." He also mentioned that the fur around the eyes laid away from the eyes, then got longer on the cheeks, then worked down to the wide jaws where the fur was much thicker. Now right here, when Dad got a good look at it with the night vision binoculars, he said that was when he said his prayers and he knew what he was seeing. His pair of binoculars were the kind that you can pick up and use with your hands, or you could strap it around your head. He couldn't get it strapped to his head fast enough, he said. I asked him how scared he was at that point. He said he doesn't remember being scared, but it was more the same feeling that he had when he was back in Vietnam. Your muscle memory takes over. You start sweating, but your training kicks in. For him, he would sort of blank out on everything except every breath he takes, and he would make sure that he had to do whatever must be necessary to walk out of whatever situation he's in, no matter what, he said. He said after battles and engagements, when they would roll backward to the bases, that's when he would get scared. When he was safe and secure and he had time to think about it, then he would get upset. It was some kind of a strange, delayed reaction. He said it was the reaction he could not afford to have while he was up in the air in the helicopters. And it couldn't be when it was happening. He couldn't think about anything, he said. It's a type of autopilot. So when they're strapped on, these binoculars, he's getting his bow ready. He wasn't thinking he wanted to shoot it. It was reflexive, as in just being defensive. What he really wanted was to leave that place, but he didn't know how it would act. He already had a bow knocked, and he's scanning all around looking for where it had gone, because it wasn't where it was anymore. It was now on the other side of the stream, which was not very wide. It looked up at him two more times as it walked along the stream bank, right to within 30 yards of him. Then one last look, and it ducked into the brush on that side, and it was gone in a few seconds. Dad said he held his breath and he waited for a long while to make sure it was gone before he got down out of that tree. It was pitch black out there, but he had marked his trail back out of there earlier that day, which he said he had always done, and he was glad of it that night. He said the whole way out he had that electric, tingling feeling that he often had in combat, like he had to be ready for anything. It took him over an hour and a half to work his way out of there back to where his truck was parked. His truck, luckily, had a cap on the back, and he had planned to sleep in there anyway. So he crawled in and slept until dawn. He got up, and he was almost deciding to leave. He said, but for some reason, he had to go back to that area at daybreak. He had to see what he could find, if anything. He wanted more answers. He left his bow and arrow in the truck and took his .357 with him. He said that he was confident with just one or two well-placed shots, he could stop that creature in its tracks, if not outright kill it. My dad was a really good shot, and he knew his stuff, so I'll take his word on that he could have taken that creature down. Dad got back out there, and he said he saw a lot of prints all along the stream bank on both sides. He said he kept walking back and forth, and he could read a lot of stories in those prints. But the print story that interested him the most and unsettled him was the set of footprints that came from the other side of the stream, right up to the tree that he had been in the tree stand. Those prints circled around in a wide arc. Then they worked their way in, closer, coming right up to the tree, where he said it looked like it walked around the base of the tree several times. Dad said he thought the tracks were very fresh, possibly even within the last hour. The edges hadn't even hardened up yet. He followed the tracks along the stream bed until he could no longer follow them because of the stream banks, where they became more rocky and they were less impressionable to make prints that could be followed. The whole way, he had had the electric feeling in the pit of his stomach again, as if he needed to be ready for something to happen. And there came a moment when he realized that he believed he was being watched and followed. He stopped and concealed himself in the brush as he would have in the war. He pulled out his .357 and kept it ready. He waited for several minutes, and he said nothing moved, and he heard nothing at all. But he stayed still. Finally, he was about to move on after about 20 minutes when he heard something across the creek. He looked over, and he saw that same creature again, or one like it. It had now come forward, and he saw it drop down and conceal itself in brush just off the stream bank. He kept watching that creature across the way. He couldn't believe he actually was seeing one again. He looked at it, but its concealment did not provide an opportunity for a confident shot with his handgun, he said. Not one that would be one of those well-placed shots that he knew he would need to drop one of those animals. He didn't want to shoot it in the first place, he said, but this was a situation where the hunter was now the one being hunted, and he was determined he was going home that day. So this impasse of staying still on both sides of the stream went on for several minutes. My father, though, would not relinquish his concealment in order to leave the area, which is what he badly wanted to do, and it appeared that neither would the being across the way. He was crouched in that position, and after roughly a half hour of that position, well, his legs were screaming at him. He was no longer the young guy who could hold a crouch for hours when needed. My dad had to move, so he worked on doing it very slowly and very quietly, and he was beginning to manage it, but with great difficulty. As he was doing this slow movement, he heard splashing like someone was walking across the creek. He quickly looked at where the thing had been across the creek, and he still sees the dark outline shape behind the brush. He wondered, had he been wrong? Had he been staring at some other dark area behind that brush by mistake? Then he thought, no, he had seen the creature at the last second as it dropped down to conceal itself right there. No, he thought, he's not mistaken. He looked as far as both ways up the creek as he could, but there was nothing for him to see. Nothing was there. As Dad was working this little puzzle out, he said the hair stood on end all over him when he heard what he called animal gibberish less than 10 yards up the stream from him. On his side of the stream. It was very close. He said it was a long string of gibberish, and it sounded almost like a question, because it ended on an upswing, the way our voices do when we are asking something, you know? He said he was frozen and ignored the pain in his legs once again, because this occurred as he was slowly maneuvering to a new position to alleviate his legs. And he was only halfway there. It was uncomfortable, but he held that exact position, he said. Once again, from close by, he heard the animal gibberish come again. It was a smaller string of gibberish, and not quite as loud. After 2 or 3 seconds, the one across the stream answered back. It was just a few bursts of animal gibberish sounds. They sounded like they were short and clipped, like it was giving short answers. Maybe yes, maybe no. Dad said he held his breath, waiting, feeling he was being trapped. Suddenly, he felt a stinging pain on the side of his head. He heard something hit the ground. He looked down to see a very large rock. One of them, presumably the one near him he heard gibbering, had hit him with a very large rock. He said he believed he could hear it breathing over to the side of him, and he knew it had to be very close. He heard twigs snap. He said he slowly looked into the direction to his right from where the rock had come from, and at first he didn't see anything. Then he realized a very large stick was coming through the brush at him at a steady pace. He stood up quickly, not caring if they saw him anymore, because obviously they knew where he was. Dad was expecting to see one of them, he said, but he was wrong. There were two of them. One of them was very large, 8.5 feet tall, and the other, which he suspects is the one he saw the day before. Both of them were male. The taller one held a large branch, like it was going to poke him with it. He looked at the second one briefly, but went back to lock his gaze with the bigger one. The bigger one was standing more forward, and he seemed to be the more aggressive and the more dangerous. Dad said that big one was radiating anger and malice. You could see it in its face and in its eyes. The big one's eyes were very small and dark, he said, and set very deep in his head under a heavy brow. But you could feel the anger, the way he was looking. So Dad said he kept looking at the bigger one. He figured if a strike was going to come, it would come from that one. Then all of a sudden, the one across the stream started gibbering again, almost non-stop. He heard it, but he would not look away from the two in front of him. He said the big one stared very hard at him and kept pointing the branch at him. Then he saw the tip of that large branch slowly be let down to touch the ground. He looked back up at the big one's face, and now he said the lips were pulled back, and he saw the ivory teeth, and he heard a low growl. And before Dad knew what had happened, he found himself lying in the stream. He thought the big one hit him hard enough with the branch to knock him over into the water, or perhaps he hit him with his arm. Either way, he had been hit rather forcefully. He had the wind knocked out of him, and as he struggled to get his breath back, the pain started. He had landed on a lot of large rocks in the shallow stream bed, and the side that he had landed on hurt, yes, but the side that he believed was hit by the branch or by the Sasquatch's arm, that side was screaming. He heard the water splash through his haze of pain, and he picked his head up just enough to see the large male standing only a few feet from him. The look on its face was still one of anger and malice. He was tapping that large branch into the stream water over and over. Dad said all he could think of was some kid he knew growing up who, when they would play baseball, would rhythmically tap the dirt with the bat while he was waiting for a pitch. It was like his way of getting some rhythm to wind up his bat. Realizing the danger, Dad was ready to go ahead and place those well-aimed shots he had thought about earlier, and he would do it on all of the creatures if need be. But there was just one problem. His .357 was no longer in his hand. It had flown loose when he had been hit. He glanced around, but it was nowhere to be seen. So now things had gone from bad to worse, and Dad knew it. He started to crab crawl backward, trying to put some distance between him and these creatures so he could try to stand up. For what, he didn't know, but looking at the size of these creatures, He thought standing up was a better way to die than lying down in a stream of water as you're stomped to death with those huge feet and listening to your bones breaking like toothpicks. They watched him as he scooted away. Dad got to his feet, and he kept backing up. He wasn't wanting to run, but he also didn't want to take his eyes off of them. Every time he backed up, they took steps forward. They were following him. They were actually pushing him, is the way Dad described it. Every so often, the big one would bring that large branch up, and he would circle it over his head as he walked, threatening Dad again and again. Adrenaline kept Dad moving, but the pain was becoming very intense from the impact on the rocks. A few times, the big one would suddenly rush forward and push Dad with the branch, almost knocking him off his feet a couple times. His lips would be pulled back, showing those ugly ivory teeth, and he would let loose a torrent of the animal gibberish, which Dad said sounded decidedly angry. When they came to the spot where Dad knew that he had to leave the stream bank and turn inward to cross over into the woods to get to his truck, well, he went ahead and turned. He had no choice. He knew he could not outrun them, and he didn't know if they would follow him all the way back to the truck, or if at any second they might decide this had gone on long enough and it was time to snack this puny human's neck. When Dad got into the woods, he kept turning around often to make sure he wasn't going to trip or run into some tree. Then there came a point he realized they weren't coming forward as forcefully anymore. After three or four times of him looking where he was going and then looking back at the creatures, and they hadn't moved forward at all, Dad said he made up his mind. He turned forward to the direction he needed to go, hastened his pace to just under a jog, and turned back to look every few seconds as he made his exit. They did not follow. On that trip, my father lost his gun, left his tree stand, and came home with what turned out to be cracked ribs and multiple bruises from landing on the rocks in the stream. I don't recall exactly when he came home that day. I was probably at a friend's house because it was the weekend, but I do remember the aftermath. I remember his ribs being taped up because my mother insisted on taking him to the doctor. I remember his bruises. He was yellow, green, and purple all up and down his sides and arms for weeks. I also remember how he was very nervous and jumpy. I had never seen my old man like that. I asked my mother what happened to Dad, because he wouldn't say. All she said was that my father had fallen out of his tree stand. When I asked a few more questions, she shushed me and told me not to bother my father. He did not want to talk about it. But I took note over the next year because all of his hunting equipment was given away to my uncles and cousins. I noted he never went hunting again. When anyone asked, he just said that he had lost his zest for the sport, and you know, with young kids growing up in the house, he thought it was best to stay at home for a while. He took a lot of ribbing about it from the family, but he did not back down. To my knowledge, he never entered woods again. Now, that was 1997, and my dad was 49 years old. He served two tours in Vietnam and lived to tell about it. For a part-time there, he was a door gunner on a helicopter gunship, and he had been shot down three different times that year, but he always made his way back out. So this wasn't a guy who got spooked easily. Something definitely spooked him bad. It was only when I was in my later teens and I had a friend who invited me to go hunting with him that my father sat me down and asked me not to go. Actually, he forcefully told me he would not allow me to go. I was perplexed and I asked him why. After some hesitation, he sat me down and he told me this story. I listened, but I couldn't comprehend what he was saying. Sasquatch? Bigfoot? What are you talking about? Why would a Sasquatch poke you with a stick? Why would one hit you? Well, none of it made sense to me. Scotty, he said, look, son, I have no explanations. I just want you to not go out there. Promise me. If there was a war zone out there, I would move heaven and earth to keep you out of it. Now, those woods aren't exactly a war zone. But believe me, there's an enemy lurking out there, and you, my son, are not equipped to fight him. Now, every time any of us mentioned something about woods or forest or parks, didn't matter if it was a grill out over in the Smokies with other family, a high school graduation excursion with a group of guys into Nantahala, maybe a family reunion taking place at a park with a lot of trees. It didn't matter what it was. Dad would tell me that that's where it happened. It happened right there in Nantahala. It happened in the Smoky Mountains. It didn't matter. That's where it happened. He would say he was wrong before he was confused. No matter where it was, that's where it happened. Turned out, he just didn't want us in the woods for any reason. He didn't even like driving through the national parks near us. So he thought, if he told us that's where it happened, we wouldn't go there. I remember Dad buying books and VHS tapes all about Bigfoot for years after that. He would talk to us, his immediate family, that is, about it, and his brothers, but no one else. Now, if we brought it up to anyone else, he would absolutely deny it. He didn't know what his kids were talking about. I guess it used to be harder to say that you saw a Bigfoot or Sasquatch. Never mind being hit by one and being so shook up, you never went back into the woods. Dad smoked no-filter Camels his whole life, at least 2 packs a day. Well, that is, until lung cancer took him when he was barely 68 years old. That was just a few years ago. But from the first day that he told me that story until his very last day, his story never changed. Well, except for the location. I appreciate that you've had a read on this. I've probably forgotten some things. I'm sorry if I have. Signed, Scott. Now, thank you, Scott, for that great story. You know, if you did forget something, wow, are you forgiven? Because I can't imagine you forgot anything. That was a very detailed story. I'm glad your father shared it with you and that you chose in turn to share it with us. All right, everyone. Now listen, everyone is anxiously awaiting the Halloween marathon. Well, I got some news for you. It's probably not going to be a marathon. I don't even have enough for an hour. I have a few small stories. I have updates from someone that aren't exactly a story, but it's updates about what's going on their grandparents' land. And I have a ton of fiction that isn't even most of it Bigfoot. So I will put it all out in time, but unless something miraculous happens this weekend, we're probably not going to have a true marathon. So if you do have anything out there, please don't hesitate to send it in to me. All right, everyone. Thank you for being patient as I had unexpected eye surgery this week, making me miss a day. I still have blurry vision, but I'm doing all right. So thank you, everyone, for the well wishes. It's nothing major. I just really thought I'd have time to prepare. You know how it is when they tell you they want to do a procedure. You schedule it, and it's like, you know, 6 months out. So, but no. They called me, and somebody canceled. So I got in at 7:40 the next morning, so. Anyway, everyone, everything is fine. Thank you for your wonderful thoughts and kind words. Okay, everyone, I've nattered on enough. I do hope that you have a wonderful weekend no matter where you are on the globe, and that we'll be meeting up again real soon. And until we do, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.